That was a good feel.
That was really good. That was the most on point, you think?
I think that was the best take so far.
Solid.
Yeah.
I'll take it. I'd just be like, oh, I forgot to hit record on the audio.
Chirps. I always chirp something.
We haven't had that in a long time, though.
Like, an hour goes by. Like, oh, shoot.
It's been years since I've seen that happen. Oh, progress.
Man. Don't tempt me. It'll happen again.
Oh.
That was the best take because I didn't hear Chris's ankles cracking.
I got some bad ankles too. Like,
can you hear it on the headphones?
I didn't hear nothing.
Slight in the background, just like. But it wasn't enough to distract.
How was your guys' day?
Kalei came from the store.
I worked at the store. Did a shift there. Sold a bunch of ukuleles.
Had a nice shave.
Yes. I finally chopped it off. I kind of look my age now.
Did you use like a... Seen somebody use, I think it was a cleaver. Is it a cleaver? Is that what it's called?
Oh, those butcher knives.
Yeah, seen this guy like scraping.
That's funny.
Away. I was like, wow. That's...
I remember watching like Crocodile Dundee when a K knife or whatever. He's like shaping like that. No, I just use
that's a man's man.
Gillette Mach 3.
Hit it.
I don't know, but.
Oh, Mach 4, I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah.
How come you put down your guitar?
Oh, I don't
know. Just at least talk about what you play.
So, this is, I'd say, I think we said this before, the flagship guitar.
Electronic first.
Oh, that's John Mayer's Olivia or something. Sponsored by it.
These things are, they kind of suck, but give me a real beer.
I like the tea, the iced tea ones. Those are good.
Would you guys play a Bahamas song?
Thank you.
Sweet. You know, next Tuesday, John Yamasato Ooh, and you two are going to make some music together. That's going to be fun to record.
Yeah. Kind of a dream come true, too, because we grew up listening to Pure Heart. And,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever played with John. You play, or you've played with John in Iron Mangle.
It was like, for me, it's like playing with him in Lopaka and Richard. It's a lot of fun. Like what you said, like we grew up listening to Pure Heart, so it's kind of like oh wow, I'm like playing my idols.
The recordings we did at Salt from what was it, 2018 or
2018?
We rushed over straight from the picnic.
All burnt.
I still love those recordings.
That was fun.
That was a very tender time for the company.
Tender. Okay. I guess. It's always tender over here. Tender loving care.
I'm pretty tender on the midsection right now.
Tenderlicious. So we still have UT200s in stock, and that's gotta be the best Christmas present.
Yes. Christmas is right around the corner. So if those of you are thinking about what to get your special loved one, friend, family member,
think no more.
Think no more, because we have a lot of instruments. Oh, you still gotta think. Ukulele site. So
I'll allow you to just stop thinking. Just buy the UT200. Wrap it up.
Have them right here, ready to go. Get them while they last. You know, they're limited supply, so.
Very limited.
Very limited.
We are running a special this month where all ukuleles under $400, you normally pay $40 for the full setup, which is free for everything over. And so we kind of put it on all the ukes, free setup. So the last couple of weeks, we've going through ukes under $500. We started with soprano. Last week we did concerts. So let's get into some tenors under $500.
Sweet.
You guys are the best.
Oh, stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Yeah. Stop it.
If you could only maybe practice before the podcast.
Well, you told me to. I was like, no, but you didn't see my hat.
The best. Sorry.
You're the best.
Your legs are so tasty. So, I forgot which. It might have been the last podcast or a podcast before. Like, there was a customer asking for the
cedar top version of that.
I think so, yeah.
Like a solid mahogany with a different top.
Solid cedar top. That'd be sweet.
Like, because if we got like the 4 series, but they were asking for something like all solid with a different top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Under like about 300 or something like that, yeah.
Right.
Kind of a spruce top.
Spruce?
I mean,
I think spruce would go.
Spruce it up.
How come you guys haven't done that already? Come on.
We are
cedar lovers.
Well, it's like all the stuff like we're thinking of is like.
But this is your Hawaiian about... dream series.
Yeah. Well.
How is cedar not in the dream? Come on.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
But it's like, I don't know. Yeah, that's a good question. Why don't we have one?
Get on it, boys.
There's probably like, I don't know, 12 new models that's going to be released next year.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe more. Maybe 16.
We'll talk about these.
So, I got the Anui Nui T3 tenor ukulele. And this features a solid mahogany top, laminated back and sides. A lot of times in the store, I'll tell our customers, like, you can kind of think of this as kind of like a hybrid ukulele. It's partially laminated and partially solid. And most times, the laminated instruments are lower price, which makes them much more affordable and price friendly.
Sorry.
With these, you get a solid top, and that helps a lot with the tone, the sustain, just overall, you know, sound of the instrument. As it gets older, it's going to sound better. But because the laminated sides and back are also part of this instrument, keeps the cost lower. So this goes for only $199. So it has a really nice sweet sound, really nice binding, satin finish, really smooth to the touch. And we got the Inui Inui gear tuners here in the back. And the rosette, abalone rosette, adds a really nice touch to the overall aesthetics of this particular model. So let's give it a listen.
Alan.
You guys want to do 4-hour podcast? You need Panasonic's, not Sony.
I think so.
Sounds really good, you know. $199 comes with a nice bag.
Yeah. Nice blue gig bag. It's actually like better than a lot of like other gig bags that come with instruments within this price range because of the padding. You know, you get extra padding.
It's a little bit more of an earthy look than a lot in that price range too, with the like, it wood binding, right?
Yep. Wood binding. It's really, really nice. So it's always good to know that there's a case to carry your instrument and protect it every time you purchase one. So yeah, every single Inui Inui instrument, regardless of price range, even the guitars, they all come with a case
just in case you never mind. Okay, I have the T30. This is all solid mahogany top, back, and sides. Really nice. This is one I pictured. I think this is the one that was on the website too. Yeah, African mahogany top, back, and sides, all solid. You got a really cool rope rosette here. Like all Inui Inui ukuleles from the factory, they come with fluorocarbon strings. So you want a nice clear tone with great articulation.
Yeah. Getting fancy here, huh?
Yeah. Gotta bust out the top shelf words. But yeah, this is the big brother of, well, for now, for the Hawaiian Dream series, this is the highest offering in all solid wood. Really nice ukulele. I'm a big fan of mahogany, and yeah, check it out. Thank you.
do this for. Tricks. What is that? Or the. The.
20.
Yeah. So that was the T30. Yeah. He's like, you thought C minor? Nope. Yeah, we'll go, what the key is that?
C sharp minor.
Oh, they just went, they modulated.
It's just going up a half step. Kind of like first was getting started. Got to.
Do they still have the same couple. Theme song?
I don't know. I can't even remember. I think it's different. I think it might have been redone. But ever since like I stopped watching TV, as you know, we got rid of all our cable stations and.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. Why bother?
I think nowadays it's like you got Netflix, Hulu, and Disney Plus. You know, Amazon Prime. So it's really good. It's a good series. They filmed a scene on like our road where I live.
Oh, really?
So they brought like all the trailers in and parked it on our property, and then the scene was there was like these I guess troublemaker guys. Police shows up at a chop shop. Because my neighbor has, he's a mechanic and he had his shop all set up, so they figured that would be like a good location. Just for that one scene of just them jumping inside of the Jeep and just driving off took like
half a day.
Wow.
Like, there was, like, taking, like, four long 40-foot containers or trailers. And it's crazy because they're all stacked with, like, food. So when the staff is setting up for, like, beverages and refreshments, it's a whole stinking tent was just packed and loaded with stuff. So, no, being the foodie I am, I ended up making friends with the guys working at, like, the security guards at the food tent.
You got to grind, too.
It just gave me whatever I wanted. Yeah. It was cool, though. The guy that was, it wasn't any of, like, the main actors or the characters from Hawaii Five-0 there, but it was the Rock's stunt double, was playing, that
cousin,
character.
Yeah.
I'm just waiting. The guy looks like his cousin. They gotta be related somehow or something. Like,
wait, isn't that his cousin?
Rock, I don't know. Stumble? I don't know.
It is. Yeah.
They're Let's like see. The same height. It's like, it's crazy. And what was interesting was that they were all talking about him too. They're like, oh yeah, he just got done like with doing some kind of action movie, so he's all bruised up. And so when you looked at him, they had to put makeup on his face because like he had a black eye.
Oh man. The stunt guys are like crazy.
Yeah. I was like, dang. They're like fearless.
Oh, yeah. So the man who does Dwayne the Rock Johnson's stunts, Tanoai Reed, is also his cousin.
Nice.
That guy, yeah.
Yep, that's him.
Yeah, they do look almost the same. He pulls more towards the Caucasian side.
Yeah.
Is that appropriate?
I don't know what's appropriate.
The lighter side. I don't
yeah.
The fairer. Fairer side of the family. I don't know. Because I can get really light skin and really dark.
Yeah, me too.
Yep. People are like, how come you don't go to the beach? I'm like, I would if I could.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
And right now we're rolling into our winter season, along with a lot of waves. So maybe sometime I'll have some put some time on the side to go Waimea body surf.
Oh man!
Ooh, yeah.
Be careful.
Oh yeah, I want to go on a small day. I'm not one of those crazies with those on those 20-foot shore breaks that are just rolling.
People don't understand, like. It's like if you go out in Florida or California, like on the North Shore, the amount of water coming in is just different. It's like powerful.
It's a giant wall. It's like the Waimea Rock is like 20 something feet tall. And when the wave covers the rock, that's when you know it's like, whoa, be careful.
Yeah.
You can be standing like 50 yards away from the shoreline and it's like, you can still feel the ground shake.
Yep. When in doubt, don't paddle out.
Just stay out.
I've gotten to watch the Eddie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I remember the last time I ever saw it was when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah. Well, this was years ago.
And just recently they had it, right? It finally happened after like 15 years or so.
Yeah.
13 or 15 years.
Yeah.
Like 2 years ago?
Long ago.
Like 2 or 3 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And I remember that year the waves were so big that at a Lii Beach park, the water was washing into the park.
Oh, that was when we had El Nino, right?
Yeah. I remember that. Like we were, I was at there's like a surf center and the waves were like coming in where you're showering. Like,
yeah.
Where you rinse off. Like the water was just washing up on the grass.
I remember.
<It's> like, wow.
Shark's Cove, mm-hmm. Another reef. Remember seeing there's this cutscene because I used to watch like was that Billabong Surf TV?
Yeah,
that always show this 20-foot wave that came over Shark's Whoa. Cove. Yeah,
dang.
Pretty sure that was Shark's Cove, and that wave was huge.
I know that whole coastal area when during winter season is just being eroded away from the waves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Feel bad for the
land
homeowners.
Masses. Yeah, it's all disappearing. It's getting pretty dangerous. Some homeowners, the water is literally like 40 feet away from their house because they're losing, the land is just like slowly disappearing.
It kind of blows my mind that people invest in those properties, but you know, you only live once and it is awesome to be right there.
Well, plus too, it's like it's the perfect place to have a house like that, but it's just the last thing you expect is big waves rolling in during winter. You
know? I think even the sound at night would kind of like be a bit much.
Yeah, actually, in my house, like I can hear the waves crashing, and I'm close to the water, but not right on it. You know, like probably like a couple hundred yards.
Right.
So. But it's, yeah, it's really loud and just, you can hear it at night, just boom. You know, yeah. You hear the waves just
pounding.
Just pounding. And it's like, whoa, it's big out there.
Yeah.
That's the only time I keep up with the surf report is when I hear how big it is from outside during the evening because everything's quiet and you can hear the ocean. And you check the surf report, it's like, yep, it was 20 something today.
Pounding. When I used to surf, I'd tap out North Shore. I'd tap out at 5 feet. Nope.
5 feet's huge.
I mean,
it's big.
It's not huge. It's manageable. But once you get into the 8 foot range, that's a lot.
That's tons of paddling.
Dangerous. Nice. And there's two ways to measure the wave too, from the back or from the face. The correct way is actually from the back, right?
Well, that's how Hawaii does it.
Yeah, they say like Hawaiian scale 3 feet, but like what you see is like 6 to 8.
Yeah.
You know, which is typically the front is going to be double or triple the back of the wave. So I can handle 8 at the most. Body surfing, that's it.
Really? That's big.
68.
It's dangerous.
Yeah.
Especially when there's a sandbar, because at Waimea, the break is so heavy. It feels like you're being like body slammed by like a strong man. Just like, what is his name? The world's strongest man, Eddie Hall or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it feels like a huge, like 300 something pound full of muscle just like slammed you into the concrete.
You know, my mom's boyfriend in high school broke his back at Sandy's body surfing.
It's dangerous.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Sandy's body surf, that is like...
That's the most natural chiropractor. You can, if you want to get your neck cracked or your back or your whole body, just go body surfing at Sandy's.
I remember the first time I went there, I was like, oh, it's sore. But there's like no water on the bottom.
Yeah.
There's rocks too now.
But you get barreled every time.
Every time.
You ever kick your own back of the head before? I did.
I've
what hit me? My foot.
It's like, was it my foot?
That's happened to me at Waimea many times. Yeah. Like going over the falls. Yeah. It's the worst.
I kicked myself in the back of the head before. Not once. More than once.
Shut up. You cannot.
Oh, no.
That's pretty flexible.
Way back when.
Right.
Like now, yeah. It'll probably just break me in half. But in high school, we used to body surf and bodyboard at Waimea.
You were such a stud back then.
Oh, no. Just, I look like this, just way skinnier. Probably like 40 pounds.
A little bit more hair.
Later. Yeah. I had a mop. Kind of hair style going on. It wasn't really a style. It was just because hair. I was lazy.
Yeah. Hawaii 5-0.
Try. I think we got it. Gotta do Johi Saishi version. Thank you. I gotta do it better than that. Sorry. Sweating. Not gonna lie, I'm like really sweating right now. Oh. Tried to bring back the shredding. It didn't quite work, but that was fun. Killer.
Oh my goodness. So talk about what you're playing.
Okay. Sorry.
Doesn't matter.
Okay. This is the TF-72A. Thin body koa. This is a laminate koa, but the koa is actually sourced from the Big Island.
Big Island koa.
So Kumu and Leolani, if you guys didn't realize yet, they're the same company. And the Kumu line is specifically the koa series. That's really it. For a thin body, you get a surprisingly loud sound.
Yeah, they all sound nice.
It's like Kala's the SSTU travel series.
And if you notice, like, it's not as thin. A little bit of depth.
And so, the Kala one has the arch back. It's like a violin.
Yeah,
This one doesn't, but it doesn't really need. You get a lot of volume out of these, and
it's kind of like cold opens.
Yeah, it doesn't matter a lot to people, but for me, I used to be a, I used to think Tusk. Yeah, you have to use Tusk nuts and saddles. It's gonna make it sound better. But after, you know, playing with Bone nut and saddles, there's a big difference. You get more of a warmer sound.
Yeah,
and Leolani still uses that, even though it's generally a more expensive option in production. They still use Bone nut and saddle.
Yeah, they impressive. They generally care about the quality of their instruments. Impressive. Yeah.
And then you got the Mangle one. So if you look, the shape is all the same. The headstock, everything.
The only difference is the wood and the thickness of the body. So this is the T85G. It's a tenor all Mangle body, front, back, and sides, laminated Mangle. And this is actually my favorite model out of the Leolani ukuleles we carry. And the reason why, it's because of how they sell.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Sell those all day.
I mean, it's so easy. I mean, these are like 180 something. It's super affordable. They sound great.
Very attractive sound. And
yeah,
the wood. Oh, look at the back.
So this one's Mangle. And Mangle has so much variations on it. That's why I love it so much. It's so unique. And it's almost like, sometimes when you look at it, it looks like abstract art. You know, super nice.
Especially in the back.
Yeah, and it actually gets really curly too. So this one is probably more on the plainer side compared to some of the other ones we have. And they're all available in different types of wood grains, and some of them will be listed individually so that you get that special, you know, crazy curly koa, not koa, but Mangle.
All of them are picture specific.
So they're all nice. So, yeah. My favorite model.
Alright, let's go to the next. Just so happens that the two best Kala tenors are our exclusive models. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't plan for it to happen that way, but...
I mean, that's what happens.
Yeah, you get to collab with good companies like Kala
and yeah.
Make instruments that are... awesome in value.
Oh yeah, definitely. And they sound good, and our customers love them. So this one that I have is actually the older exclusive model out of the two tenors that we're featuring. And this one actually came out, when was it, like 5 years ago, around there?
It's been about 5 years.
Yeah, maybe around longer. Five, maybe longer, maybe six, seven.
Yeah.
But this one is actually based off of the ATP, which was a similar type of build, but with different types of wood. This one is called the ZTP, CTG, CE, which basically stands for a Zerikote solid cedar top with the electric and a cutaway. And if you look at this instrument here, as I turn it from the sides to the back, you'll notice the Zerikote start to come through. Most times this wood is associated with a lot of high-end custom ukuleles. And Kala does a really great job with incorporating all these really nice exotic hardwoods into their line of instruments. This comes with the Kala onboard active pickup and preamp. So the cool thing about any of the electric models from Kala is that they have these built-in tuners in them. So you don't have to worry about fussing with a clip-on tuner if you lose them, you know, sometimes because they're so small. With this, all you need to do is just hit a button. You can get tuned up. Just remember to turn it off. Otherwise, it's going to drain the battery. If you need to swap out the battery, battery compartment is located here right next to the jack where you plug in the quarter-inch cable. Slotted headstock, geared tuners. The whole body is in a gloss finish. Check this out. Yeah, it's give it a sound sample.
Solid cedar.
Cedar.
This one is the K-A-A-S-M-H-G-T-U-V-X-Y-Z.
QRS.
Yeah, so all solid spruce top, mahogany back and sides. And Collie, they use really nice mahogany all the time. It's cool. This one's not stained like the SMHT model, which is nice. It has a very natural look to it. The spruce top brings out a very nice and punchy, but not overly bright sound. Still very mellow because of the mahogany back and sides. This one has been around for... This one's a newer one, right? That was a... This is the first to come out.
Yeah. Oh, this is 5 years too. Though.
At least 5 years, yeah. And something I didn't know, apparently came on these ukuleles for years, is X-bracing. Oh no. The other day at the shop, I was like, I mean, this happens all the time, where I just have a random thought like, oh, this I forgot to check if it has an X-bracing or not. So I put my finger inside. I was like, yeah. So it's no longer a 3-fan bracing. They use the same kind of X bracing on their, like, the Elite series, right? And that just adds more movement to the top, so you end up getting I hear more sustain too. Like, I hear more body.
It's more punchier too,
like more volume. Yeah, that was a little bit loud. I heard the
nice warmth though to those, even though obviously spruce is bright.
Yeah, I think what helps is the satin finish
and mahogany.
Yeah, it's a very woody kind of sound.
Yeah, it sounds really nice. I like how the spruce just helps carry the mahogany sound a bit further out in front.
Generally, mahogany's not super loud, but
it's more, well, it can be, but commonly not, you know.
Also, yeah, depends on how it's built too.
Oh yeah.
But it's not known for having like a, you know, like a punchy sound from, yeah, you know, koa wood.
Yeah. It has more of like a darker kind of tone. This has a little bit more presence, you know, in it because of the spruce.
Yep.
And I like the rosette upfront too.
Upfront kind of sound, right?
It's, yeah,
in your face.
And it's like, oh, that's what ukulele sounds like. It sounds good.
It's like a aged bottle of wine. No, it's not.
I kind of like it better non-bound too, because we had them round the edges.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so it has like a more comfortable feel than the other kalas.
So
in that way,
we're gonna be doing the part of the podcast. Okay, anyways, sound sample, quick sound sample.
Should have included Pono in this 6 under 500 because they're our best-selling ukes and they make awesome stuff under 500. Although most of them are, you know, over 500, but yeah, they've got super great options in the like AT and MT models
and the deluxe models.
Yeah, there's plenty there, but. But yeah, we'll do like a whole Pono feature sometime before Christmas. Yeah. Let's end this one with some of, we got in some new Romero creations.
Actually, another big reason why, I'm pretty sure, another big reason why you're stuck on YouTube is because of music, too. Like, you find one song you like, it kind of leads you down the rabbit hole of just all these other bands that are pretty cool. Yeah. And there's you just want to share them.
Yeah, totally. What are your guys' favorite channels on YouTube? Can you think of it?
I have a bunch of car people that I follow. So there's the Smoking Tire, Car Wow, this one auto journalist from Japan. I forgot. E-Auto Life is... the name of that. It's mostly just car stuff. Throttle House from they're from Canada. They just review cars.
That's cool. And
if you had tons of money, what would be the car you would buy?
Oh,
some kind of customized.
No, I've been wanting to drive an Audi, like an RS6
Avant. I'm talking you're filthy rich.
I'm not into like super.
Oh, I
super,
thought because like, no, but I thought because you follow these like car things like
yeah. Maybe, you know, if I had to like splurge, it would be like a Bentley or a Rolls Royce.
Really?
Yeah.
Gross.
Like maybe a Rolls Royce Wraith. Is the name of it?
A Wraith, yeah.
I think it's like $400,000.
And then there's a Phantom, which is like $750 or something.
Oh, I don't even know what I was insulting there, so I apologize.
No, I mean. No, just Bentley has that like old rich dude.
Yeah, kind of, totally. Yeah. Or
but the
just made it rapper, I guess.
Yeah, specifically the Bentley Bentayga. Let me see if that.
Oh, that's okay. You don't have to look it up. Just random questions.
Because it doesn't look like a, you know, super flashy car, but.
But what's some good like music channels that you guys. Paul David's is good for guitar stuff.
Candy Rat Records.
Candy Rat.
Oh, yeah.
That's where you had Andy McKee, Don Ross.
That's where Antoine. Andy McKee got huge.
Yeah. Drifting. That was the song that just... Yeah. That was like one of my most favorite channels like ever. And then...
they featured a lot of good big artists.
Yeah, a lot of them got their start from being featured on there. And then there's a bunch. And then recently, over the last like 5 or 6 years, I really got into watching a lot of travel vlogs. Because that's something I love to do. I love traveling. I love to learn about different places around the world and what type of culture, customs, and especially the food. what's available, because I've always, ever since I was a little kid, dreamt of traveling, and I love learning more about places and what the rest of the world
has. Can you think of a YouTuber that you like that does travel vlogs?
Well, there's Food Ranger, there's people like Mark Wayans or Weans.
What is that guy, Chen? Is his last name? He's
Mike Chen, Strictly Dumpling.
Yeah, I think it's cool.
Yeah, so like channels like Strictly Dumpling, there's this guy named Mike Chen, and he travels all around Asia or even other parts of the world and shows you what the type of food is like over there. What can you get at a convenience store? Like, he'll go out and bring all these items like from Japan. Like, a lot of people don't know that you can get some high quality sushi there.
Oh yeah. Hell yeah.
I mean, it's just awesome to be able to see what all these different cultures around the world has to offer that's different from what we have here. And then I recently got into watching Sam Chui, which is an aviation kind of like channel, where he goes on all these planes and tries out all the business classes, first class seats, and he documents the whole thing from when he arrives to the airport, the check-in experience, the lounge, and then when he boards. And then that's when I was like, man, I would really love to travel on Etihad.
That's the plane ticket, like $20,000.
It's like $20,000, and I was like, what? You have your own... like almost like an apartment suite.
You have a shower.
You have your own personal shower. And I was like, I mean, I'm probably not going to be... I don't know if like I'll ever be able to experience something like that. I might have to like save up forever and then splurge my whole life savings on that one plane ticket.
After you showed me that, it's like I would want to do that once.
It's crazy.
That's the most expensive airlines in Dubai, right?
I think or just like in general, Emirates. Like commercial... So below that would be Emirates, and that's the other big seat.
Wait, sorry, I was adjusting things. What is so great about it?
So
you get treated like a king.
With the residence in, find it on the Etihad plane ride, you get a private check-in. So when you arrive at the airport, there's a place totally separate from all the other terminals, where it's just only for the first class customer. And so when you walk in, they already have your tickets printed for you. So they hand you it, escort you into the airport, and then you go straight to the lounge. You have a private, your own personal masseuse. You can get a massage.
This is the airport lounge?
This is the airport lounge. You didn't even get on the plane yet. Okay. There's a barbershop. You can get...
oh, wow.
Yeah, you can get like a beard trim. This they have like a cigar room.
Yeah, or this is extra. I sent you the video.
It's all included. And then they have five-star dining. And they serve you lobster, champagne, like Dom Perignon.
And then in your cabin space or whatever, you have a freaking bed in there.
Yeah, and then when you get on the plane, there's a bed. And there's a whole room to yourself that you can close the door, lock everyone out. You don't see any of the other passengers.
But it must cost like...
$20,000.
It's ridiculous.
I mean, like how much does it cost to rent a private jet?
Probably way more than 20.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's guaranteed.
But then, I guess all of the other amenities also are probably even better than, like, just renting some janky small...
Oh, yeah. I mean, when you go into the bathroom, it's all high-end designer products. Like, they even give you Bose headsets, like, and you can keep it.
It's like, that's the least they can do.
And then, they have that. But I think the reason why it's a dream for me is because I've traveled a lot and
it sucks traveling.
It's always, most of the time it's economy. Hey, you know, it's like, not going to be high maintenance or anything. I can dream of going on a plane ride like that, but yeah, it would be pretty nice to be able to just bring whatever you want with you and not have to worry about a thing, especially if you're on the plane for 10 hours.
Man, you can't even get me to upgrade to first class. I don't know.
Watch the video. You'll probably be like, hey, guess what, boys?
You know how many ukes I have to sell to take that one flight? Nope.
One more better?
Well, no, the profit is nowhere near.
Or four petrels.
I'd have to, like, thinking of profit, yeah.
No, wait, not more. Four petrels, just two.
I would take a loan out to ride that.
You know, there's actually what's really cool is that a lot of these travel guys that get on these flights, they're not paying full prices. What they do is they book a first-class ticket on this airlines, on a certain airlines, that has a transfer or partnership flight where you have to get on this. Because you bought the highest ticket that this company offers, their partner airlines will give you the highest seat that they have. So you get a $20,000 seat for way less than 20 grand.
Coming in hot at $18,000.
$2,000 discount. Just $18,000. It's probably going to be like realistically price? Like 6 or 7 grand.
That's still pretty high.
It's still pretty high, but compared to...
How much for a flight to Kona?
Well, right now it's
$7,000.
$300.
Like, by the time you get in, you get rested. All right, we're making a landing.
You're like, can I just stay here for a while?
You know, what's funny is that, like, folks back in the mainland, when you travel from state to state or city to city, it's really cheap. But when we travel from island to island in Hawaii, it's expensive. It's like $150 to $200 one way.
It yeah, used to be $99.
It's crazy. Well, yeah. I mean, shoot, back in the day with Mahalo Air, it was like $23 we were paying to go to Maui when we were doing repairs.
I remember like Aloha, and then there was Island Air, and then Ohana.
Then there's Moku.
Mokulele. That's the best airlines to use for inter-island travel because you can take all your bags on with you. There's no weight limit. Wow. And when you're waiting for your plane to arrive, they're pretty on time.
And there's only 20 people on the flight, yeah?
Yeah, and it's like $150 round trip or $180
That's
or something.
That's a
deal. I think. I don't know. I could have gone up.
We went to the Big Island this weekend. And it was so great to go somewhere. It's just All right, Clay. How come your tiny tenor looks...
a bit different.
Gorgeous.
More glorious than normal.
Well, so this is a brand new model from Pepe Romero and Romero Creations in collaboration with our good friend Daniel Holt. This is the Tiny Tenor X. And there's a, as you can see visually, there's already a difference. This uses more of like a higher grade of koa. So when you see these Tiny Tenor X's, you're gonna actually notice that there would be more character in the wood grains, as you can see from this one. Pretty much most of everything is the same spec, except for one little detail. Now from here, you can't really see it. But once I take this and put it on its side, you'll notice that it's a lot deeper. There's more depth here as far as like how the body is. We measured a normal tiny tenor.
We didn't measure, but we...
or we kind of like compared it, and it is just a tiny bit larger or thicker over here. And I guess that's what contributes to the sound that comes out here. Compared to a normal tiny tenor, this has a lot more low end, more bassier, a more rounder type of sound, and it's really warm. I like how it responds. It still has a good amount of volume. In fact, it has more volume than some of the other tiny tenors out there, mainly because of this little change in construction.
It's like a grand tiny tenor.
Yeah, I mean, this is the top of the line tiny tenor that Pepe has available. So I think we only had maybe one or a few that came in. And hopefully if you guys like these, we'll try to get more. So let's give it a sound sample. Thank you.
Very nice. Is a part of the same series with the upgraded cola, or is it just this one is?
No, that's
just a normal.
Yeah, we should have probably picked a different one to feature, but it's okay. Just because that is a really nice cola.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is one that we have samples on. Why don't you two play something together on these two?
Yep. Sounds for Uncle John Cruz. Was Missing You. Mm-hmm. That's one of my favorite songs. So, damn. This is such a nice.
Yeah.
Ukulele. It's the same size as a tenor. The neck is a lot wider, so your fingers aren't crammed. Certain gilelas or gitalelas can be challenging to play, especially if you have large hands. These narrower necks make it a little bit hard to fret certain chords, but this is nice. It took a little bit of getting used to, but thank you.
I would
play this, like, you know, I'd play guitar a lot, mostly, primarily, maybe. This is really comfortable because, like I was saying, it's a tenor size, but I have all the bass notes.
Yeah. So it still isn't, like, tuned like an ukulele, but it's basically guitar capoed at the fifth fret.
Basically, classical guitar. You have a lot of range, too.
Oh, those overtones are nice, too.
Should do it with a pick.
All from that.
Yeah, I mean, natural reverb. Man, it sounds so good.
Where's the reverb pedal?
It sounds more like the pedal on pianos, the sustain pedal. That you realized you wanted to be a musician?
No, I just remember just really getting so immersed into playing and just learning more. I just got obsessed. And my intention was not to become a musician. Oh, I was just like,
yeah,
I just want to get as good as I can and we'll take it from there, you know. It was just, music was just something I loved. I'm pretty sure it's the same thing with Corey. And I didn't really consider myself a musician until I first started, until my first album. Like, even though I was getting some small little paid gigs here and there, it was just, I was like, wow, I can, you know, get paid to do something I love doing. And then it became a thing. And then I became a musician before I even knew it. I was. I always just consider myself, oh, I'm just an ukulele player, you know. And still to this day, I look at myself like, oh, I'm just an ukulele player, you know. I just get to play ukulele more often than, you know, other people.
Well, it's your profession, though.
I mean,
along with other things, but what about you, Corey?
I remember watching Jake play on TV. This is when I think Pure Heart already came out.
Was it the Nohoku?
Yeah, I think it was that. And my friends too were like, oh, you gotta check out this song, Body Surfing. And that was one of the first songs I was like, wow, this is, I didn't know you could do that on ukulele. And yeah. I just gravitate towards music. I like to fidget with things, and I like I guess, I don't know. I don't think I ever really decided I wanted to do it. I just asked my dad one time, hey, can you teach me a song? And he's like, oh, yeah, cool. Here's, you know. That played that a million times. Pissed everybody off.
was that the first song you learned?
Yeah.
Do you remember the first song you learned?
Me?
Yeah.
It wasn't even a song. It was just like strumming C for like 2 months straight.
Yeah, right.
And I didn't even know that. Like, you could strum with your other fingers besides just your thumbs. I was, like, full-on just strumming like this. I was like, how is that person, like, you know, strumming more efficiently than me? I'm like, oh. But then when I first actually learned a real song, it was actually Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star.
Nice.
That's what basic I started off with. I did not start off with anything complicated. And for a few years, I was the bottom of my class. Like, everyone was better than me.
Hey, that's a good... Guys, keep that in mind.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, like, if you're bad at it in the beginning. Yeah. Everyone sucks in the beginning.
You don't show your potential right away.
Didn't Michael Jordan... He didn't make the cut or something for, like... Was it a college basketball team or something? And
oh, yeah, that's the fuel he needed.
We'll show these guys up. And, I mean, that's Michael Jordan.
Yeah, he just used every negative thing to just be like jet fuel.
Yeah. You know, one of the things I loved about everyone being better than me in the beginning is that that means that there's just that much more people that you to learn something from. So that was a big part of how I actually started improving. Anything and everything that someone did that I didn't know what that was called or how to do it, I would ask them. And then I would take that one thing and torture my family at home with, like, making their ears bleed because everything I played was, you know, it didn't sound good. And then eventually things started to come into place. It wasn't until maybe about 2 or 3 years into my playing when it started making sense. For a while, it was just like, what? See?
I wonder how many potential great musicians were stifled by a parent that was just like, shut up!
My parents never really like did anything like that to me, but I could see that I was getting on their nerves just because I wouldn't put it down 24/7 and I was homeschooled. So when you're homeschooled and you do your schoolwork at home, yeah, you get it done real quick and go back to ukulele, you know? Oh,
yeah. There were times where I spent more time on ukulele than video games, and I used to play video games a lot, but
oh, me too.
There are days where I'll just play ukulele for like 8 hours.
Yeah,
and
I bet those were the day, like the days we were playing ukulele instead of video games. My parents were probably like, oh yes.
And then it gets to a point, it's like, all right, now you're playing too much ukulele, put it down.
They start threatening you, it's like, I'm gonna take the ukulele away if you don't do your homework.
Oh, no, I've been threatened.
No.
When I get punished, my dad's like, no ukulele. What?
For me, it was no ukulele for one or 2 months.
Oh, that's brutal. Mine was like, no ukulele just for one day.
Wow.
Yeah.
You're lucky. Mine was 1 month. I deserved it. Like, if any like aspiring musicians out there, yeah, you do have to put in a lot of work, but don't forget about the other important things that you should be doing as well. Because when I fell behind in some of my schoolwork in high school, that was a big wake-up call. So, take my advice and keep up with everything.
Or not, and just keep playing music.
You know, it's funny, it's because, like, my performance in my academics didn't go down because I was struggling. It went down because I just wasn't doing anything.
Yeah, same here. My dad's like, why aren't you doing well in school? It's not because I'm stupid or anything. I just don't want to do it.
Yeah.
I just waste time skateboarding.
I would cram for every test. Like, I didn't, like, I just did enough to, like, get it right.
And, like, what they say is the people who procrastinate the most are usually geniuses.
So I am far from a genius.
Yeah, I don't know.
I wouldn't say
that's not a label I deserve. Yeah. But I'm a procrastinator. I got that part.
Master procrastinator.
So I wonder if you guys can do like a version of body surfing on these two instruments to kind of close out the session. Is that asking too much? Thank you guys so much. Let us know in the comments what you think and what you'd like to see and any questions. We're at theukulelesite.com. We work on every instrument that goes out after it gets approved. And we are here for you with any questions. And we'll see you next week. Aloha. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for all of you that watched our podcast and kept up with every single episode. It's always a real treat knowing that you're here joining us and playing some ukulele and sharing some of our experiences with music and the community that comes with it. We'll see you again. Don't forget to hit the like button, the subscribe bell, and the notification buttons to make sure that you're updated with all of our newest content. Signing off of all of us here at the Ukulele Site, mahalo. We'll see you again next time. Ha ha ha.